was born in New York City on 42nd Street, on the East Side. That was before it was the fashionable East Side. And after about 3 years, my father was a baker, and he bought a bakery out in Queens and Woodhaven, so that's where I was raised.
Was it kind of an urban upbringing then? You know, I mean, in the city? Or?
Yes. Yes.
You know, in that era for kids, you know, running around, you know, before computers, before television, all of that, what kids do for fun in the summers, that kind of thing?
Well, I guess we played in the streets, played punch ball and that type of thing, and roller skated in the streets, played hockey.
Were you the kind of kid that liked school?
Yes, pretty much, yes.
You know, when you walk into a classroom full of kids, you get the full spectrum of personalities. There's the quiet kid and the loud kid, the joker kid, there's the full spectrum. If they'd walked into your classroom, which kid were you?
Probably the quiet kid.
So you're a pretty well-behaved, quiet kid. Did the Depression affect your family?
Well, my father owned a bakery, and it did affect them. So they had the apartment upstairs where we lived, and he had a couple of rooms. He made two apartments out of it so that he could rent the extra apartment. And then he rented the bakery. Another baker took over. So it was tough times.
Is there food always on the table?
Oh, we always had food on the table.
Tell me a little about your mother. You talked about your dad, what he did. What was she like? What was her sense of humor like?
Well, she was a good mother, and she had a... I had an older sister who died at the age of 14. She had an appendix up. She had pains in her stomach, and they took her to the hospital. They operated on appendix, and she died on the operating table, 14 years old. So that was a tragedy in our household, and I don't think my mother, for years, did get over it. But I guess she was about 42 or 43. She became pregnant, so I had a younger sister, 14 years younger than me. So with the baby, she managed to get over her tragic feelings with the loss of a daughter.
So you almost had two families in a way.
Yes, yes.
And what do you remember what you felt as what a 14-year-old seeing this baby come into the family?
Well, I remember my mother calling me aside, and she talked about one of the neighbors who had one of the boys had a younger sister, and So she said how nice it was for him to have Johnny to have this younger sister, and finally she came across that she was expecting a baby. She was breaking the news to me.
You know. Do you remember when Pearl Harbor was bombed?
Yes.
Tell me how you found out about it or how you reacted to it.
Well, I remember quite well. I was going to Queens College, New York City, and on a Sunday afternoon, I was doing homework, and I had the radio on, and they announced that the Pearl Harbor was bombed, so that's how I heard of it.
Wait, do you remember what your reaction was to it?
Well, real surprise, you know, and just couldn't quite believe this was happening to us.
Did you have some sense you were gonna, this was gonna impact you personally? The sense of being called up or that kind of
thing? At that point, I wasn't thinking of that. No.
Tell me the story of how you got into then the Army Air Corps.
Well, I was going to Queens College, and the draft age was 20. And I guess this was 1942. And in the fall of that year, the dean called us in, all the men, boy students, and said that the draft age was probably going to be lowered 20 to 18. And he suggested that we all sign up in some type of reserve program, and said that we probably could finish our schooling before we get our degree before we were called up. So I signed up for the Army Air Corps. I was 19 in November, and December I was accepted. I took all the tests and the physical. And in January, I was in basic training in Atlantic City. That's how long it lasts.
Tell me about the training in Atlantic City.
Well, in Atlantic City, we had basic training, and we were in the hotels. So the first, I guess about 4 days, I was in a hotel Senator, and we were up on the 10th floor in a solarium, and they put double-decker bunks up there. And of course, 10th floor, there were elevators in the hotel, but when you have bunks in all the rooms, and six to a room instead of two, you didn't use the elevators. So we had to go from the 10th floor on the steps, down for breakfast, back up to get your coats, back down again. But of course we were 18, 19, 20 years old. And they would take us out to convention hall. You got your uniforms there, and they had different meetings there. You go, and you'd march up and down the boardwalk, and they'd take us out on the sand, sometimes a PT, physical training. And then after the first 4 days, we were in the Chalfont Hotel. And the Chalfont was a famous old hotel, and when we went in there, they assigned us at different rooms, and different ones would come out and say, "Oh, you want to see our bathroom? The tiles are black and yellow, and someone in salt water and fresh water showers, and someone else said they had purple tile showers." So it was quite a thing. But again, there was not two to a room, it was six and eight to a room.
And all.
And we'd march up down the boardwalk. So I have a friend, a very dear friend, Jean, and she likes to go to Atlantic City today. She likes to walk the board. Oh, no, no. She didn't know there was a boardwalk down there. So we get down there occasionally and we enjoy it. But it does bring back memories. And not too long ago, the Chalfont Hotel is no longer there. And I asked around, and different people I asked weren't aware of the Chalfont. But I did finally find someone who said the Chalfont was torn down some years ago, and it's now the parking lot for Resorts Casino. So that's where the Chalfont was.
All those stairs are gone. Why did you choose the Army Air Corps?
I'm not sure. I just seemed better than the infantry.
Had you ever been in an airplane?
No.
Well, take me through then, sort of the training experience that you went through. Where did it go from there?
Well, at that time they started a program of CMTC, and went to colleges. It was a 5-month program, but they just initiated it, then started it, and so I was in one of the first classes and went to Grove City College, and before you went into cadets, and we were on a train, and from Nashville, and they didn't tell us where we were going, and finally the sergeant said, "You're going to Grove City College." And so we all looked at each other, "Where is Grove City College?" And he said, "Well, Grove City, Pennsylvania." And of course we said, "Where is Grove City? Grove City, Pennsylvania. But that was a start, and then it was to Maxwell Field and continued from there.
Was your intent or hope to become a pilot?
Oh yes, become a pilot, but a fighter pilot. So at each stage, they would ask you what your preferences were. It was a fighter pilot, twin-engine bomber, and four-engine bomber was at the bottom of the list. That didn't work.
So you're in Pennsylvania. What happened after that?
Well, from Pennsylvania, it was down to Maxwell Field, Alabama, and then the training was all in Arkansas.
Describe the training to us. What was your experience?
Well, it was a PT-23. It was the first my first experience with flying, and I guess as I recall, it was like 8 hours before you could solo. And it was an open cockpit. It was quite an experience. I enjoyed it, and was always kind of amazed that I was up here looking down at the ground. You know.
Did you find the flight training difficult? Did you, especially since you'd really never had been in an airplane before? But did you take to the training, that kind of thing, or would you find it particularly challenging?
I think I just took to it and didn't have any real problems.
So you took the initial training. Where did it go from there then?
Well, it was in Arkansas, and then went to was it Nashville again, it was for the B-17 training, and that was down in Florida.
Do you remember the first time getting on a B-17, or what your impression was of the B-17?
I don't really recall, but I remember going up into the front, pulling myself up into the front end of the plane, and a couple of years ago, we were at a base that had a B-17, one that flies around the country, and I said, I pulled myself up in there.
Do you remember those first couple of times flying a B-17, what it was like? I mean, you're in a big multi-engine plane. What was it like graduating to the larger aircraft?
It was quite an experience, yes.
How did the B-17 handle compared to the other aircraft you'd flown?
I thought it handled pretty well for a big plane like that, yes.
And talk about when you found out what kind of aircraft you were going to be assigned to.
Well, I think almost all of us wanted to be fighter pilots. So it was kind of a disappointment, but accepted it.
One of the interesting things about World War II is how you take all these personalities from different parts of the country, pull them together and say, you're now a crew and you have to work together and your lives are all dependent on each other. What was it like when your crew came together? What were the personalities like?
Well, it was kind of interesting. I first was assigned a 10-man crew. We had a bombardier, and the co-pilot, he had just been married, Fred Warburton, and the bombardier was about 26 years old, married, and he had two children. He had been a bombardier instructor for a couple of years, and he and his buddy asked to go to combat, and so here I was. I guess I was just 20 years old. And I had this 26-year-old with a married and had a child.
And you're in charge. Were you comfortable with the leadership role as the pilot?
Yes, it went all right, yes. And they all seemed to accept it me as say, a good pilot. And, you know, we picked up some plane and flew overseas from, picked it up in Florida and then flew up to Dow Field and up to Goose Bay and flew across from there. So,
Were you at all a little nervous about that long journey across the Atlantic?
I guess I was a little nervous, yeah. We stopped at the Greenland, I guess, and we weathered in there for 30 days before we could continue.
30 days? What did you do during those 30 days?
Played cards.
You know, what was, especially during those 30 days, you know, weathered in, what's your relationship with, back up and ask it another way, did you have a style of command, I mean, and how you related with the officers, the enlisted men, in a way, what did you learn about leadership and how you connected with these guys?
Well, of course, the commissioned officers and the crew were separated, so we weren't with them all the time. You know, we would see them, but they all accepted me, and I felt good about that. Particularly the older fellow, you know, I wondered, but he indicated that he thought I was a good pilot, you know, and as a instructor, a bombardier instructor in this school, he flew with many different pilots, so I felt good about that, that he felt I could handle it.
Vote of confidence.
Yes.
When you're up in the air, the crew's all, you know, the 10 of you are in the airplane, how GI is it? You know what I mean? Yes sir, no sir, that kind of stuff.
I think it was more not GI. I think it's more fellowship or a feeling of being together.
Well, you were weathered in for that 30 days. Do you remember anything else about that? Even how you passed the time over all that water to get over to the UK?
That was a concern. It was a long, long trip, and I was happy to see land.
Because did you go across as a group or as a single aircraft?
We followed. We didn't fly in formation or with a group, single aircraft, but a plane took off, I guess, every 5 minutes or so. I don't think we saw any along the way.
So you've got to have confidence in your navigator.
Oh yes, get us there.
Well, you arrived in the UK. You had this brand new B-17. Did you get to keep it?
No.
No, they. Was that a disappointment?
Well, when I was over there, we weren't assigned a particular B-17, so I didn't have a B-17 like a lot of the earlier crews. They had they named the plane and but. We just flew whatever was available. It was kind of interesting to get to this little town in England.
In Parham, Framlingham?
Yeah, Framlingham.
Did it feel like you were in a very different kind of place?
Oh yes, oh yes.
What did the base, what was it like for people who've never been there? What was it like there?
Well, you know, we really didn't have that much contact with the local people because we lived on the base and did everything on the base. But we did look forward to getting our 48-hour pass to London every so often.
What was it like in wartime London when you guys would go in there?
Well, of course, they had the blackouts and But we spent more time in like the PX and the United States government quarters and things. So the British people had it pretty tough with their rationing and that.
I guess, was it obvious it was a war zone in places?
Yes.
How so?
Well, they, no lights at night, you know, and that type of thing, and rationing. I do remember that at Christmas time, I guess in the United States, cigarettes were tough to get or hard to get, and an aunt of mine sent me a carton of, I guess they were Lucky Strikes, and she had a tough time getting them, you know, and because we were getting them for a nickel a pack.
What was the relationship like with the British people? I mean, were they happy you were there, or what was your experience?
I really didn't have that much contact, and I think it just accepted us.
Back at the base, what would the base look like? I mean, is this the middle of a city somewhere? What did it look like?
Well, it was all in the farmland. All the bases were up in the farmland and the Quonset huts. So we slept there in Quonset huts and the PX with Quonset huts, and everything was Quonset huts.
What was it like living in the Quonset huts?
Well, let's see, how do we do that? I guess, well, because the office and the enlisted men were separate. And the co-pilot, navigator, the commissioned officer, we were commissioned were in one barracks, and the enlisted men were in another barracks. So my crew, the bombardier, navigator, and co-pilot, we were all together. So it was a close relationship.
Talk about food, staying warm.
Well, we did have a stove in the middle of the barracks, and it was about that high and about that round, and it was cold in the barracks, yes.
Did you always have enough fuel?
Yes, we didn't seem to have a problem with that, but the stove was too small for the big barracks.
How many missions did you fly?
35.
Do you remember having any anticipation as far as that first mission?
Well, the first mission was kind of interesting. I guess we had an engine shot out. And before that, the mission was, there was a front between England and the continent, and so the formation couldn't go, we would go through it and would have to break up the formation, so they flew to the south and kept gaining altitude to get over the top of the front. So that I think it was, as I recall, an hour or two out of the way, and then we had to get back to the target, and of course it used up so much fuel, and then by the time we got to the target, The people were starting to run out of gas, and they said, go in individually, you know, not formation, because flying formation used more gas than going straight. So we dropped our bombs, and then they said, go back to England on your own. So some of the planes flew on to Russia. And of course, it was closer than going back to England, but I didn't think about that, and no one on the crew to navigate it and say anything. So we're back to England, but we were losing gas and moving gas from one engine to the other, and so I landed then on the continent, and So we spent, and then they call the base, they, I get over the landed in England, but couldn't get back to the base because we didn't have enough gas. And they got contact with the base, and they said that they were having an inspection. Some general was going to inspect the base, so they couldn't come down to pick us up. So we spent 3 days in the emergency landing field. And this was the first mission. And I said, this is number one. Help.
Only 34 more to go. And, you know, at one point you said you landed in the continent. Did you landed in England, but at another base.
Emergency landing field.
And I guess, do you remember sweating whether you had enough gas to get across the channel?
Well, I was concerned. Yes.
You weren't to the point, though, you were throwing guns out of the plane to lighten it or anything. And so that was your first mission. Do you remember seeing flak on that mission?
Yes.
For people who have no idea, what's flak and what was it like?
Well, one thing that I always said, that as a pilot, I always flew on the bomb run, and I was concentrating on flying, so I could see the flak out of the corner of my eyes, but my mind was concentrating on flying, and that was much better than the rest of the crew who were sitting there watching this flak all around under their flak suits covered up. So I was always, seriously, I was always thankful for that I could concentrate on flying and didn't have to worry about the flak.
Did you have a routine with your co-pilot as far as trading off or any kind of thing like that?
Well, I would trade off with him. He would fly, I think about every 10 minutes or so or 50 minutes, I would fly and then he would fly.
Just to keep the fatigue down and that kind of thing.
But the problem was the first mission we were hit by flak, an engine was out, and he was hit in the hand with a piece of flak. So he didn't fly with me anymore. I had a different co-pilot, and usually new crew, they had an experienced pilot go with the new crew in the co-pilot seat. And the co-pilot, I would get the co-pilot. So I had a pretty much a new co-pilot most of the way.
Did that make you a little nervous, always having a different co-pilot?
I'd say yes, a little concerned.
You're not going to remember all 35 missions, I don't think. But were there missions for one reason or another that stood out in your mind?
Well, the one I remember, they said the target was Mannheim in Germany. And I said, oh, I have relatives in Mannheim. My mother was born in Austria-Hungary, and she came to the United States, married my father, and her sister came with her. She married a man and went back to Germany and lived in Mannheim. So. When I heard Mannheim, I said to the crew, I have relatives there. And we get over the target, and again, everything is nice and quiet. You know, the crew is all quiet and covered up in their flak suits. And all of a sudden, it's, don't shoot, Uncle Louie, don't shoot. It's Herbie up here, don't shoot. It broke the tension.
You know who it was on the crew?
Yeah, it was the waist gunner, Gillespie.
Did you have any reservations in that mission, I guess, personally?
Well, not really. I said I had relatives there, but my mother and her sister didn't get along. I'm not just sure what caused it. So they weren't close. So they didn't correspond through the years and had no contact, so I didn't have any close feelings to them.
Did you ever see any German fighters out there?
Well, One of the earlier missions, we saw German jets, and they were just introduced, I guess, in those years, and they would sit quite above the formation and sit up there, and they would wait for a bomber to be hit, and or, you know, lose an engine or something, pull out of formation, and when they pulled out of formation, that German jet up there came down and made one pass and got that bomber. What I remember them telling us that they didn't have that much fuel, so they just stayed up there and waited for that. They knew a bomber would be going out of formation, as soon as it did, made the pass and got the bomber.
Did you actually see the jets up there?
Well, I would see them, but I concentrated on flying. But like if the co-pilot was flying, I could, yes. There weren't that many of them, but because it was, they didn't have that many.
Did your plane ever come under attack by fighters?
No.
You mentioned your co-pilot was injured in the hand. Were any of your other crew members ever injured?
So I had a different co-pilot for the rest of the missions.
But nobody else got hurt?
No.
No. You know, through your 35 missions, tell me what makes a good pilot. You gained a lot of experience. What worked? What made a good pilot?
I'm not sure. Just being very conscientious, I guess, about what you could do and what you should do and what you shouldn't do. Just like driving a car. A young fellow goes down the highway at 65, 70 miles an hour, weaving in and out, which isn't the best, and flying is the same type thing. You know, obey the rules would make a good pilot, stick to within all the rules.
I guess that's one of the questions. What were the rules? You know.
Well, again, you know, you could. With a bomber, wasn't with a fighter plane, you could do loops and snap rolls and that type of thing. So with a bomber, you were more restricted, but you could dip and pull up down a little bit, accelerate.
Were there things you could do to avoid flak?
Not really.
You just went
right
through it. Would you see other B-17s go down?
Yes.
Do you remember how it impacted? How do you deal with something like that? Because you could have just as easily have been you.
Well, like I say, I always appreciated the fact that I was a pilot because I had to be concentrating on the flying, so I couldn't be worried. I wasn't worried about the flak. My mind was more on keeping the plane straight and level.
There is a point, though, you're back at the base and not flying the plane and thinking, and I guess I'm wondering how you handle the stress of 35 missions and. Let me ask it another way. What was in you, in your background, or something that allowed you to mentally keep it all together and to lead a crew?
I think it was just the responsibility of flying a plane and keeping everything together without worrying about what's going to happen.
There must have been something in you. You were raised with a certain discipline, or there was something in you that put you in that position. Do you have any sense of what it was? It came from my dad. It came from my mom. You know, what was in your background?
Well, my parents both had German backgrounds, and my father was German, and my mother was born in Austria-Hungary, German-speaking people. And Well, I guess when I was raised, I was involved with with the church and activities at the church, and Then at a young age, I delivered newspapers, and it was 7 days a week. Sunday morning, I had to deliver papers before going to church. So it was that type of thing.
Was there a certain faith aspect? You're up there, planes are going down, and people are getting killed. And I know you're focused on flying that airplane, but is there some aspect of where your faith fit into all this?
I guess so.
You weren't reciting the Lord's Prayer, though,
no.
As you're going on the bomb run, right? How close would those planes fly to each other?
Well, in formation, it was, three in a... wingmen, and that's one thing, I flew wing each time. Early on, I was asked to be a lead crew, so I mentioned it to the crew. They didn't like the idea of being lead crew. And
why was that?
Well, I think they felt that the Germans were aiming for the lead planes, and I guess that was basically it. And then another thing was they didn't fly as many missions, close together, so they would be over there much longer. Instead of going every 3 or 4 days, they'd fly maybe every week or two. And so I think that had something to do with it too. So they voted against it. Now, it wasn't a democracy. I could have said we're going anyway, but I did say we didn't want to be it. And a lead crew. I don't think the commanding officer felt too good about that, so we seemed to fly a lot of missions.
When you flew your 35th mission, did you know it was your last mission?
Yes.
Any kind of... Let me ask it another way. As you were getting that 33rd, 34th, 35th mission, where you knew you were going home after that, were you doing a countdown, particularly when you got near the end?
It didn't bother me.
Do you remember coming home on that 35th mission? I mean, I'm picturing champagne, kiss the ground, anything happen on that last mission?
Nothing other than just very happy.
Did you buzz the field, anything like that?
I think we did take a little crack at it, yes.
When you flew your 35th, the war in Europe is not over.
It ended a few weeks after I finished my last mission. And when I came back, because the war ended then in Europe, there was they didn't need that many pilots. And I was... put on a reserve, I could go home, and if they needed me, they would call me up. So I went back to school, but I did go apply at the airlines to be a pilot. However, and I was in the metropolitan area and went to all the different airlines, and it was the same story. They all had pilots that flew with them who were in the Air Corps. They were all flying C-47s and that type of thing, and they were all going to come back, so they didn't have a need for pilots. But Pan American said they had the possibility of going to Panagra, which flew in China, and I decided I didn't want to go to China, so I went back to school and got a degree.
What was your degree in?
Economics.
And then what was your career after the war?
I went to work for IBM, and at that time IBM had punch cards? Were you aware of that?
My dad used to make punch cards for IBM.
Okay. Yeah. And so I worked with them, and it was one of the presidential elections, and I guess what was the competitor? UNIVAC?
Yeah. No. Something like that.
Something like that. They had, when they were tabulating the results for the election, they had that on TV, and IBM had computers, but they weren't on the market. They had them in their laboratories, and Thomas Watson Sr. was the founder of IBM, and he was retired. His son was the operating officer, and the son said, well, the competitor was using the cards, and so said we should come out with our computers now. And the old man Watson, Mr. Watson, said, there's no market for computers, but the son overrode him, and IBM went ahead.
And the rest is history.
Right.
A couple of just miscellaneous questions. When you finished your missions, were you there when they flew any of the Chowhound missions to Holland?
Not at the base. I was on my way home. Mm.
And did you fly home or take the ship home from Europe?
The ship home. The Ile de France.
What was that like, beyond that ship?
Kind of crowded. But we did have two meals a day. I was in one of the rooms, but we had three double-decker bunks in there, you know. I mean, a suite wasn't just a bed. They stuck a couple of bunks in there as well. And I came back with my crew, and the crew was down in a hole someplace, and they had double-decker bunks all over the place.
What was it like to, after all those missions and being over in Europe in a war zone, what was it like getting back to the U.S. when you finally came? Did you come into New York?
Into New York,
yeah.
Yes.
What was it like when you actually saw home?
Felt good.
What was the homecoming like? I always picture the Norman Rockwell, you know, moment. You know, mom, dad, little sister. What was it like when you got home?
Well, they were happy to see me, and I was happy to see them.
When you do think back, are you proud of your time in service?
I would say so, yes.
Why do you feel like that?
Well, I think it was a real challenge, and to get through that all, someone who didn't have a license to drive a car could fly a bomber.
Were you proud of your group, the 390th?
Oh, yes.
Why was that?
Well, I guess it's just like going to a college or university. You have team spirit, or you all stuck together type thing.